good night.
Yeah, the turnout is so good. It's so good to see everyone. Ignore that. That's nothing. It's in here somewhere. Ha! Here we go. No need to thank me. That's Mr. Tayto. I'm a bit obsessed. I can explain if you want and tell you all about the Irish theme park formerly known as Tayto Park.
If you don't know, Tayto is an Irish crisp brand, or as the Yanks would call it, potato chip brand, that is most famous for its iconic mascot, Mr. Tayto, aka the love of my life. Since 2010, Mr. Tayto has had his own theme park, Tayto Park, a fact that I naturally became obsessed with. I would argue that it's a source of Irish national pride that Tayto Park exists, even a lot of the people who are proud of its existence haven't actually been. If you're hearing my accent and querying whether I have the credibility to make such a claim, I would like to clarify that I am a citizen of the glorious country that is the Republic of Ireland, as well as a former resident of the dump of a city that is Dublin. I can show you my passport and list my chicken fillet roll all off by heart if you don't believe me. I've been obsessed with Tayto Park since my first visit in 2018, and whilst I wouldn't call it an ironic obsession because I do genuinely enjoy the park and think some of its attractions are world class, one of its attractions is world class, but like my standing for the best Pixar film Cars 3, it's always been a bit, at least the extent to which I talked about my love of Tayto Park. Because there's just something funny about it, and this isn't me laughing at Tayto Park, it's just always been an inherently funny proposition. However, everything changed on the 15th of February 2022 when the news was broken that at the end of the year, Tayto Park would be changing its name. And the amount of people who messaged me asking for my opinion, I've never felt more popular. I think more people texted me on this day than on my birthday this year. And this was such a big deal, and everyone I spoke to knew it was a big deal, I knew it was a big deal, but none of us could articulate why. Because at the end of the day, it's just the name of the theme park. Next year, the attractions and overall experience of the park will be largely the same. Why does it matter? Well, in the intervening months, I've done a lot of thinking, I've done a lot of research, and I've even made one final trip over to the park in its Tayto era to pay my respects. And now, as we sit on the precipice of the park being about to be renamed, I think I finally understand exactly why the Taytoless Park will never be the same. Here we go. Part 1. Tayto History 101. When Tayto Park announced it was being renamed, a lot of people, myself included, were surprised to find out that Tayto Crisps and Tayto Park were not the same company. I think it was fair to assume they were one and the same. On the back of each packet, you had promotional tie-ins to the park, bits of the theme park experience felt specifically branded to promote Tayto Crisps, and as beloved as Mr. Tayto might be, he's not your obvious go-to IP to license for a theme park. However, as the press release of the name change states, Tayto Crisps were rescinding their title sponsorship, which is such a weird phrase to hear in the context of a theme park, being more comparable to an energy company sponsoring a sports stadium. So the implication here is that Tayto the Crisps were paying Tayto the Park to have their brand on the door, which seems straightforward enough. But digging further into it, is a lot more complicated than that, and requires an understanding of the weirdly convoluted history of Tayto. In 1954, Tayto was founded by Joe Murphy, an entrepreneur who previously introduced ballpoint pens and Ribena soft drinks to the Irish market. Tayto's main unique selling point was pre-flavouring the crisps. At the time, most brands included a small sachet of salt that you could use to flavour the crisps yourself. Whilst Tayto was probably not the very first company in the world to do pre-flavoured crisps, it was definitely the first to introduce cheese and onion as a flavour, now comfortably the most popular flavour of crisp across both Ireland and the UK. Joe Murphy's ability to not only identify a gap in the market for flavoured crisps, but combine it with a distinct brand is what helped make Tayto pop off. From the very beginning, Mr. Tayto was part of the brand, appearing on the original packet in his iconic red jacket and clutching a bag of Tayto. And personally, I think basing a crisp brand around an anthropomorphic potato is a unique and eye-catching proposition. Because there's only one crisp brand based around an anthropomorphic potato, right? Well. In 1956, 2 years after Tayto began in the Republic of Ireland, another Tayto brand launched in the island of Ireland. A year before, a man called Thomas Hutchinson had bought a castle in Northern Ireland, and not sure what to do with it, he naturally decided to turn it into a crisp factory. Being aware of Tayto's popularity south of the border, Hutchinson approached the Tayto company, getting the license for the Tayto brand and recipe for use outside of the Republic of Ireland, and launching his own version of Tayto. This brand also has a Mr. Tayto as its mascot that I was originally going to describe as the Luigi to the original Mr. Tayto's Mario, but I feel like he's more of a Wario. Is this problematic? Am I going to get threats from Northern Irish Mr. Tayto loyalists? Northern Ireland's Mr. Tayto also wears a distinctive red jacket, but pairs his with a matching red hat and red trousers. He also has a larger, more prominent head and a skinnier body compared to the overall rounder appearance of the original Mr. Tayto. I would say visually, this Mr. Tayto is more of a Mr. Tayto head, but using that name would probably get them sued. Aside from their different looking Mr. Tayto, this version of Tayto is probably most recognizable for its distinctive yellow packaging, as well as the brand being built around the idea of Tayto Castle, the castle I mentioned earlier where production for this version of Tayto still takes place. And, like their counterparts in the Republic of Ireland, this version of Tayto have also dabbled with tourist attractions, offering tours of Tayto Castle. This is much closer to what you might expect from a crisp brand tourist attraction, offering a behind the scenes look at their production facilities, although there was also an opportunity to meet their version of Mr. Tayto at the end of the tour. Unfortunately, this doesn't seem to have reopened since the pandemic, and it makes sense for them to be particularly cautious when this is an operational production facility rather than a dedicated tourist attraction. I know there are more important questions politically and culturally about the implications of Irish reunification, but I'm really curious what would happen with Tayto in a united Ireland. Would the two Mr. Taytos have to fight to the death? Mary Lou, what's your plan for Tayto in a united Ireland? If you don't think this is an actual serious thing, I want to point to a story about a man called Mark Ferris who ended up in the Belfast High Court for illegally selling Southern Tayto north of the border. These brands and companies are very similar, but they're not interchangeable. So the two Tayto brands continued on as a key part of life both north and south of the border, but in 2006, the now owners of Tayto in the Republic of Ireland, drinks manufacturer C&C, were struggling against their rivals from Britain, Walkers, and so put up the crisp part of their business for sale. One of the interested parties was actually the Northern Irish Tayto Company, the closest we've come to a united Tayto, but instead the brand was bought by Largo Foods, a company owned by a man called Ray Coyle. Originally a potato farmer from County Meath who supplied Tayto with potatoes to make their crisps, he was a notable entrepreneur who first gained national attention in the 80s. Due to debt, he had to put his farm up for sale and decided to do it via a raffle, selling 4,000 tickets for £300 each. When he decided to buy the Tayto brand, it cost him 68 million euros, and so in order to fund this, he had to partner with a major German company called Intersnack. When Coyle took over, he reinvigorated the Tayto brand by leveraging Mr. Tayto's popularity through various marketing stunts, including getting Mr. Tayto to run for office, trying to find Mr. Tayto a wife, and even publishing a hit Mr. Tayto autobiography, which, imagine owning, that would be ridiculous. A couple of years after buying the Tayto brand, Coyle's outside-the-box style of thinking began to lead him to have ideas about opening a theme park, particularly inspired by the likes of Hershey Park and Busch Gardens in the States, started by chocolate and beer companies respectively. Notably, whilst both Tayto Crisps and Tayto Park were owned by Coyle, they were separate companies, although there was natural opportunities for mutually beneficial cross-promotion between the two.
When I bought the Tayto name, I had the opportunity of calling a great name because Tayto was well known all over Ireland.
Yeah.
I was a good calling card. And the reverse was, if the park was successful, it'd be great advertising and marketing for Tayto.
A big part of what gave Coyle confidence in the project, beyond having the rights to the Tayto name in terms of recognisability, was the location, a plot of land opposite his crisp factory in County Meath, just a short drive away from Dublin, but also not far away from the border with Northern Ireland. One large downside due to this choice of name was the inability to advertise directly north of the border due to the ownership rights over the Tayto name. Instead, only PR and word of mouth would be able to draw in visitors from Northern Ireland. The park opened on a relatively modest budget of 60 million in 2010, which was still an enormously risky project to open in a recession. However, this ended up working in the park's favour. It was much easier to justify a family trip to County Meath for the day for a relatively reasonable price than a much more expensive holiday abroad. The park sat right opposite Largo Foods' crisp factory, and the two companies acted as happy neighbours under their shared owner Ray Coyle for a number of years. That was until 2015, when Ray Coyle was forced out of the company he founded, Largo Foods, by the German company Intersnack. When Coyle had partnered with Intersnack to fund his purchase of Tayto, they bought 15% of his company. However, they put into their contract that they could buy a further 25% of his business every 3 years at a fixed price if they so wished, exercising this clause in 2015 to take over the company. With Ray Coyle losing ownership of Tayto, this meant the run of this distinctly Irish brand, being Irish-owned since its inception in 1954, sadly came to an end. This naturally also caused complications for the rights to the Tayto name being used at the park, now that both companies weren't owned by Coyle. Whilst unconfirmed, it appears that as part of his exit deal from Largo Foods, Coyle negotiated the rights to continue using the Tayto name at the park for a number of years. In 2018, Coyle appeared keen to continue using the Tayto name at the park in the future, saying of his relationship with his former company,
"I cooperate with them, we hopefully will continue to use the Tayto name. We do good business with them and we're across the road."
But presumably negotiations were unable to take place to renew this at a reasonable price. Ray Coyle sadly died earlier this year, but I'm glad he got to see his dream of Tayto Park come to life, and the park continues to be a family-run business, with his son Charles now in charge of running the park. So this is how the rights situation ended up, where on the island of Ireland, you have three separate companies owning three separate entities, all of which are called Tayto. Tayto Crisps in the Republic of Ireland, owned by Intersnack, Tayto Crisps in Northern Ireland, owned by Tayto Group, and Tayto Park in the Republic, run by the Coyle family. But due to Intersnack not renewing their title sponsorship deal with Tayto Park, this name will be changing at the end of the year. Complicated. So that's why Tayto Park is changing its name, but why does it matter? Part 2, Tayto as a brand. Despite the confusing history and shared name, I do actually think that the Republic of Ireland Tayto Crisps is one of the strongest brands within Ireland. I mean, it's a brand so strong that people bought Mr. Tayto's autobiography. A potato. I bought his autobiography. I bought the autobiography of a potato. Twice. According to surveys conducted by sponsorship consultancy firm Onside, people's view of the branding of the park was extremely positive, with some of the most positive views of any sponsorship throughout Ireland. Granted, this is partly due to people not even thinking of it as a sponsorship due to people's assumption that Tayto owned the park, which, given its history, is understandable. But I want to break apart Tayto as a brand and understand why people care so much, as I do genuinely believe that Tayto Park is losing something by losing the name. Now, I don't have a marketing degree, but I do clearly have too much free time, and so I've learned a bit of brand marketing theory. In 1986, French professor Jean-Noël Capvera created a framework called the Brand Identity Prism. Now, I'm not going to go into all the details of how this model works, but Capvera identified six key factors that make up a strong brand identity, and I'm going to look at each of these in relation to Tayto. Number 1, physique. So this is the physical aspects of the brand that the consumer can visually perceive and see. This encompasses the logo, iconography, colour schemes, stuff like that. This is clearly something that Tayto excels at, with their key brand asset, Mr. Tayto, being instantly recognisable across Ireland as a symbol for Tayto as a brand. In the same way, almost no one will look at the Nike swoosh and think of Adidas or another sports brand, basically no one in Ireland is going to look at Mr. Tayto and think of Walkers or King. This is due to how distinctive Mr. Tayto is as a visual signifier, but also the consistency of using him as part of the brand since 1954. Sure, his look has been refreshed a few times over the years, most notably getting a CGI makeover in the late noughties, but he still looks recognisably the same now as when the brand started. He's such a key part of the brand that Tayto recently did a stunt called Where's Mr. Tayto, centering around temporarily removing him from the packaging, which is the sort of stunt that only works if you have a distinctive enough design element that people would notice and even miss its absence. Even beyond Mr. Tayto himself, there's a clear visual identity to the packaging that is consistent and recognisable. You have the blocky blue font combined with the red and blue colour scheme, which, whilst not as intensely iconic as Mr. Tayto himself, helps it be spotted easily on a supermarket shelf. I'm not sure how recognisable the logo by itself would be out of context, but still, most brands would kill for one asset as strong as Mr. Tayto. Number 2, personality. This is imagining what your brand's human characteristics are, what it would say and do if it was a living thing. This is really weird in the case of Tayto, as it's a brand that's literally anthropomorphized. Mr. Tayto as a figurehead is a personification of the brand. In terms of what his, and by extension the brand's, personality is, I think it's a sense of a reliable friend who's always there for you. Take a look at this ad, for example. Here Mr. Tayto is very much portrayed as a friend who has your back, there for you if you need someone to support you, comfort you, or generally sort you out. This makes sense when you think about people within Ireland growing up with this brand. It's always been there for them and widely available, and as such, Tayto embodies this reliable friendliness. Number 3. Culture. According to Capra, culture is the collection of values that feed into or form the basis of a brand. Whilst it doesn't have to be, this is often a brand's country of origin, and in this case, Tayto's Irish heritage is a huge part of the brand. One thing is that due to the Tayto rights situation, this is a brand that is exclusively sold in the Republic of Ireland. So unlike, say, Dolmio selling a version of Italian culture to an international audience, here is only interacting with Irish consumers. Sometimes these cultural links are done in a more on-the-nose way. But mostly, I think due to not having to fulfill any expectation of what Irish culture is to an international audience, it's able to lean into a specific form of Irishness. Irishness as an attribute is not homogenous, and instead Tayto taps into the Irish sense of humour. Mr. Tayto is inherently ridiculous, and yet that's part of the charm and appeal. A lot of the advertising is genuinely very weird and surreal, and it feels almost like a national in-joke, feeding into this cultural sense of not taking things too seriously. Its exclusivity within Ireland means that it's often mentioned as one of the most missed things by Irish people living abroad. It's a calling card of home comforts, a symbol of an Irish person's experience of living in Ireland, directly in contrast to the leprechauns and dye-in-the-river green form of Irishness experienced by the Irish diaspora, particularly from one country that I'm not going to name, but if the boot fits. Number 4. Relationship. This is the development of a relationship between the consumer and the brand, so what the consumer expects to get out of the brand beyond the minimum functionality, in this case, crisps.
So, have you tried Tayto before?
Are they just crisps?
Yeah. No, they're not just crisps.
What are you doing?
You mistake to make.
This is easier to talk about for a retailer brand, where a good example is great customer service. For other brands, it could be their online social media presence. One notable part of Tayto's social media presence is their pages are not called Tayto or Tayto Crisps, but Mr. Tayto, continuing to use this figurehead as a personification for their brand online, deepening their relationship. Well, at least in theory, because in practice it's not the most interactive or impressive brand social media presence. Although they've started doing some content with influencers, which...
Mr. Tayto.
Personally, this doesn't work for me at all, but maybe I'm just not in the right target demographic for this content. But by far the most notable social media moment was when the original host of Irish talk show The Late Late Show and national treasure Gay Byrne died, they decided to tweet out this now infamous picture of Mr. Tayto. Beyond social media, a big way that Tayto have built this further relationship with the brand beyond the crisp itself is the experience of Tayto Park. By being connected with the park, Tayto is part of an impactful, meaningful experience, which you then continue to associate with the brand, forming a stronger, more meaningful relationship. I remember 2 days after I visited Tayto Park for the first time, on my lunch hour, I went to Londis on Grafton Street and ordered a Tayto crisp sandwich for the first time. And I blame that poor decision on the deeper relationship I built with the brand through my visit to the park. Number 5. Reflection. This is how the brand reflects and portrays its target market. It's easy to think of Tayto simply as a family brand, and this was definitely leveraged in part for the launch of Tayto Park, but interestingly, this isn't the kind of consumer primarily featured in their advertising. In their ads, the humans that Mr. Tayto are interacting with are adults, and his 2015 campaign in particular was designed to turn around declining meaning and relevance with millennials. Rather than trying to portray their audience as something aspirational or fantastical, there seems to be an intentional focus on those featured being ordinary, everyday people, which adds to the surreal humour of Mr. Tayto popping up in their lives. In reality, Tayto has a broad demographic that eats it, but it's interesting that the consumers it portrays are a little bit different to what I would have intuitively expected. Number 6. Self-image. Self-image concerns the way in which consumers of a brand see themselves and how the brand relates to that. This is most clearly seen in terms of luxury brands. If I wear Gucci, it enhances my self-image by tying the brand into my identity. Not that I've ever bought Gucci, but I do have a Gucci eye mask I got for free once, and I wear it on every Ryanair flight just to flex. At first, I really struggled to think about how this related to a brand like Tayto. I can't really picture people clutching their bag of Tayto and showing it off. However, I do have an hypothesis, and it came from analysing my own reasons for buying Tayto when I lived in Ireland. So one thing I noticed living in Dublin was that it was quite cool to be patriotic, which was very different to my experience living in Britain, which, if you look at any history book, makes sense. People are often looking for ways to assert their Irish identity, be that through speaking more Irish, drinking specific drinks, or engaging with certain content. And I do think this can link to choice of snack. If you have the opportunity to choose between an extremely Irish brand such as Tayto versus one available in a bunch of other countries, it's an obvious choice in terms of creating a certain self-image. When I lived in Ireland, Tayto was my go-to crisp brand. I pretty much never ate Walkers, my default brand here in England. And part of that was this when in Rome instinct, but also I think I wanted to be engaging and immersing myself within Irish culture and feel a sense of belonging to it. Now, I was probably doing this more self-consciously than a lot of people, I guess due to my insecurity over how much I belong to this Irish identity, but this was one small way I could help create a self-image of someone who, despite the accent and other British attributes, felt more Irish. So that's a summary of why Tayto means so much as a brand, which hopefully contextualized why people aren't happy with the name change. But you may be wondering, beyond the name itself, how far does the brand actually manifest in the experience of the park? Part 3, Tayto's presence in Tayto Park. So now I'm going to talk about what Tayto Park actually consists of, the attractions it has, and to what extent the attractions and the park as a whole are linked or not linked to Tayto as a brand. I'd previously visited Tayto Park in 2018 and 2020, but decided in order to fully examine the role that the Tayto brand plays within the park, one Saturday in September, I took the first flight out of London over to Ireland to spend one final day at Tayto Park. Honestly, it was a pretty miserable experience, mainly due to it raining heavily the whole day.
It's raining quite a lot.
And it made me realise how badly this park is designed for wet weather, despite being built in, you know, Ireland. So Tayto Park is the largest theme park within Ireland, but also Ireland is a pretty small country, and as such, Tayto is a fairly small park. However, it used to be much smaller, as when Tayto Park opened in 2010, like Copperface Jack's on a Tuesday night, there was absolutely no rides. Whilst the park at opening was less like what you picture a typical theme park to be like due to the lack of rides, it was probably closer to what you'd picture somewhere called Tayto Park to be like. It had more of an overt attempt to tie in the various attractions to the Tayto concept, with the cheese and onion and salt and vinegar car parks, the crispy maze, they should have tried harder with that one, the Spudhara playground, I don't get this one, and the Potato Hunters Native American village. Jail. At this point, by far the biggest draw to the park was a fairly decent sized zoo, which to date still makes up a fairly high percentage of the park's footprint and identity. It's also what's drawn them the most criticism publicly within Ireland, and that makes sense as zoos are a somewhat contentious issue. The difference is how they've chosen to respond to said backlash. In 2018, due to ongoing media speculation about their animal mortality rates, Tayto Park released a statement revealing that 30 of their 377 animals had died in 2016, a mortality rate of 7.9%. Now, I'm not an animal expert and don't know enough about how bad these figures are in comparison to other zoos or general animal life expectancy. But I do know that people's gut reactions to news of animal deaths are going to be quite emotional, and that you'd have to be careful and measured in the way you phrase and frame a statement in relation to such news. So instead, Tayto Park said,
"Unfortunately, death is inevitable for creatures great and small, and despite our best efforts, so it was at Tayto Park."
Seriously, Tayto Park, just hire a PR firm next time. It feels fairly generous to even call this early incarnation of Tayto Park a theme park, due to the average funfare at least having, you know, rides. I was gonna say at least it's putting the park into theme park, but actually looking at reviews from the first year, one key criticism of the park was that even the foliage hadn't properly grown in yet. Major expansion for the park started from 2015 onwards, and interestingly, none of these new additions tried to tie into the Tayto brand as directly and overtly as much as the opening lineup did. Still, a lot of these attractions added to the park, which have some level of theming to them, do feel distinctly Irish in their choice of theme. Be that Irish history on Viking Voyage, Irish mythology on Cú Chulainn, and taking a plane to emigrate on Flight School. That's not actually the story of Flight School, but it might as well be. The two main headliners both have a notably higher budget than the rest of the park, with more of an effort put into trying to create a unique and distinctive experience you can't find elsewhere. The first of these was the Cú Chulainn coaster that opened in 2015, that was built by the Gravity Group and marketed as Europe's largest wooden roller coaster. Obviously, the term largest is a bit ambiguous, but this wasn't true by any debatable metric, with Colossus at Heide Park in Germany being taller, longer, and faster than Cú Chulainn. Someone must have realised this, because later the claim was awkwardly downgraded to Europe's largest wooden roller coaster with an inversion, which is still a weird claim for a couple of reasons. Firstly, Europe didn't have any wooden roller coasters with an inversion, so this is a moot point. If there aren't any others, then it's also Europe's smallest wooden roller coaster with an inversion. Secondly, I don't think this coaster has an inversion. I thought an inversion is when you go upside down and this coaster doesn't. There's an overbank turn later on in the ride where you go right on your side, and being at such an angle on a wooden roller coaster feels pretty wild, but it's not an inversion. But now I'm doubting myself. Perhaps I need to check the definition of an inversion. Maybe it technically qualifies. Is Tayto Park gaslighting me? I'm no coaster expert, so this might be sacrilege to say, but out of the granted fairly limited number of wooden roller coasters I've ridden, this is a strong contender for my favourite. The initial drop packs a real punch, especially when you're sat in the back row, and there's a good level of speed and momentum throughout the whole ride. It might not be the longest in Europe, but it's still a decent length, lasting 2 minutes and 45 seconds, which feels especially lengthy compared to basically any coaster in the UK. And whether the bank turn is or isn't an inversion, it's still a unique and exciting element that adds an extra thrill later on in the layouts. Honestly, if you go on a quiet day and get 4 or 5 rides on it, it's comfortably worth the price of admission alone, and building a world-class coaster in Ireland was a sound investment to help anchor the park. In terms of the thematic elements, it's a bit more of a mixed bag. The coaster is named after the Irish mythological warrior, who would be a recognisable name throughout Ireland, even if the exact details of his myth might not be as widely known, which is a natural fit for a roller coaster theme where the name but not really any elements of the story are being used. You're not going to be lost going on this coaster if you don't know the lore. Now, I'm not someone who believes a coaster has to be heavily themed to be good, but the choices here are a little strange. When heading towards the coaster, you pass under a dramatic archway with a statue of Cú Chulainn, and walking through is a really exciting tone setter for the coaster experience, as well as a fun way to tie in the namesake myth. But weirdly, this isn't quite the entrance to the attraction itself. Instead of passing through this archway and seeing the gorgeous wooden roller coaster in front of you, you see the unthemed Endeavour flat ride and a basketball hoops game, and have to turn right to see the coaster. It just feels like this expensive and impressive thematic element is quite disconnected from the attraction itself, and I'm not quite sure why this decision was made. Beyond this entranceway, there's not a lot of theming. The front of the train is adorned with a Cú Chulainn figurehead, up the lift hill are the flags of the different Irish counties, which I don't believe has any connection to the Cú Chulainn myth, but maybe I'm wrong. And the overall aesthetic of the wooden roller coaster somehow, at least to me, feels a better match to this mythological theme than a steel coaster would. Overall, it works in being a statement-making coaster that plays into a unique form of Irish identity. Cú Chulainn is a name widely known throughout Ireland and little known beyond it, weirdly paralleling how people perceive the Tayto brand itself. Sure, it is quite different, but it's similarly playing into an authentic form of Irish identity, very different to the more international pandering version found in certain other tourist attractions in Ireland. Next to Cú Chulainn, and continuing on the Irish historical theme, is Viking Voyage, the park's other major attraction, a log flume that opened in 2017. This attraction is sponsored by Ireland's Ancient East, a marketing brand used by Discover Ireland specifically to promote the east of Ireland, directly in contrast to the more widely known and visited Wild Atlantic Way in the west. Which is interesting, as Discover Ireland as a sponsor is presumably more interested in engaging with international tourists than those who live in Ireland. Entering under the signs of this attraction, you could tell that they had a budget and were spending that sponsorship money well, and the queue winds through various different huts, showcasing what life would have been like during 1014 AD in Ireland, including some with props that you can pick up and play with. Well, for most people, your kids can pick up and play with, but in my case, it was me. There's also some different interactive elements throughout the queue that you can trigger, some nice photo ops, as well as signs with information on different historical Irish sites of interest to tie into the island's Ancient East sponsorship. I think it's often hard to do a sponsorship in a way that adds rather than detracts from an experience, and this is very firmly in the former camp. I thought these signs were really interesting and educational. One really small detail I love about this queue is all the straw on the ground as you walk through. This may sound like I'm really easily pleased or just need to visit a farm, but it's just such a tactile detail that wouldn't last 6 weeks in an Orlando theme park. People would be taking the straw home and selling it on eBay. In fact, that was my favourite thing about this entire queue line. This environment that you could really physically engage with and touch, go around and explore, and wasn't fenced off, and it made the wait time, which was my longest of the day, go by really fast. There's nothing I love more in a theme park than a well-themed queue, and this is firmly in my top 10 in Europe. And yes, I have a ranked list of my favourite European theme park queue lines, why don't you? Unfortunately, the attraction, while solid, doesn't live up to the sheer excellence of the queue line, with a fairly forgettable main drop, although it does have some lovely moments like a cool lift hill through a Viking helmet, plus, spoilers, a great backwards drop. Now, the way this backwards moment is themed is really interesting, taking place within a Celtic monastery with an authentic round tower as part of the design. When Vikings invaded Ireland, they notably plundered monasteries, and that appears to be what's happening in this scene. When we enter the monastery, we can see the axes in the door ahead of us as we move onto a turntable before we turn around and are ejected out of the monastery via a backwards drop. The recreation of this monastery is really cool and makes the scene so distinct, but I'm curious what the backwards drop is meant to represent here. Could it be the Vikings making a swift exit with the treasure they've plundered? It could be, but backwards drops typically are used to represent something going wrong. So our boat is entering a monastery and then being ejected out with force. Could our boat being thrown out be an act of God? Yes, it is. I say so, this is canon now. If you've been on a boat ride that has a backwards maneuver, then you know at some point the boat has to go onto a second turntable to start going forwards again. And the difference between these two turntables is noticeable. The first one is a detailed, unique representation of a Celtic monastery, whilst the other is a blank black box with metal railings and safety labels. The difference between these two scenes is extremely jarring, and I genuinely feel like they ran out of money by the time they got to the second turntable, because to me that's the only explanation that makes sense to explain this enormous gap in quality between the two scenes. The decision to theme both Viking Voyage and their other major investment, Cú Chulainn, in a specifically Irish way is an interesting one. I really like this choice to draw on the rich mythology and history of Ireland, which is far more distinct than just going with the typical theme park cliches. Obviously, Vikings invaded a lot of countries apart from Ireland, and whilst a fairly common media trope, are surprisingly underutilized in theme parks, at least compared to the likes of cowboys and pirates. But even if they were more common, the way they're framed here is in a particularly Irish context, making it more unique. I'm a big fan of when theme parks draw on the stories or mythologies of the areas or countries that they're in. It's a big part of what I love about a park like Efteling or a ride like Hex at Alton Towers, and I'm really glad to see Tayto Park with these two investments create a park that feels more distinctly Irish. It's notable, however, that both these attractions, whilst adding to the Irish feel of the park, are doing so in a way that's very different to Tayto. I mentioned earlier that a core part of why Tayto as a brand is so effective is its Irishness, but also that the quality of Irishness is not homogenous. The kind of Irishness Tayto plays with is irreverent and humorous and self-deprecating, whilst this is more, I don't want to say serious, but grounded. It's one of that rich mythology and history that Ireland has, versus representing a certain contemporary Irish sensibility. These, whilst not necessarily clashing, are emotionally quite different from each other, and it is a notable change when you compare it to the opening day lineup of mainly crisp pun-focused attractions. It showcases the park's shift from simply reflecting the brand identity of its namesake and instead creating its own identity separate from this. Outside of the headlining attractions, the rest of the park's current lineup is generally a bit more generic, with less of an attempt to tie into either Irishness or the Tayto brand. There's two extremely similar kiddie coasters, Dino Dash and Flight School, and whilst these are different coasters by different manufacturers, if you blindfolded me and sat me down on one, I'd not be able to tell you which one I was on. The main difference between the two is the theme. Flight School has an airport theme, which is a contender for the least appealing theme I've ever seen on a coaster, whilst Dino Dash has a dinosaur theme, adapting a previous walkthrough dinosaur attraction into its queue line and with various models of dinosaurs dotted throughout the ride experience. And honestly, Velocicoaster who? Do you get two laps on Velocicoaster? No, I don't think so. Elsewhere, there's a bunch of fairly intense flat rides, which I look at and say thank you next. There's a 5D cinema. I have no idea what makes it 5D versus 3D or even 4D, and I didn't go in to find out. There's a bunch of kiddie rides, most notably a Nissan Tayto driving school, reminiscent of those found at Legoland. There's two identical Vortex walkthroughs at opposite ends of the park, which were presumably on a 2-for-1 special when they bought them. There's one of those talking theme park trees that Jenny Nicholson is obsessed with.
If I were a tree, what a tree I'd be.
And finally, there's a bunch of hotlines in the toilet, in case your day at Tayto Park really isn't going well. Whilst the park has largely moved away from the crisp-themed naming conventions of its earlier days, there's still many ways that the park is taking aspects of the Tayto brand and integrating it into the park. The most obvious of these is Mr. Tayto as the park's mascot. Theme parks often have a costumed figurehead that is a character that children can meet within the park and can be used as a symbol of the park. Here, obviously, Tayto Park has a distinct advantage, having a character that people already recognise and like. Weirdly, despite the fact I've seen lots of footage to prove there was a Mr. Tayto costume character within Tayto Park, I personally never saw him. Granted, the first time I visited was midweek during term time, the second time it was a global pandemic, and my most recent visit it was ridiculously wet with the impending divorce from Tayto looming. I'm still a bit bitter though. However, despite Mr. Tayto not being physically present on the days I visited, he is still very much an omnipresent figure in this park. There's a life-size statue of him that you can take a picture with,
in his iconic red jacket,
the man himself, Mr. Tayto. I'm gonna miss him. A topiary of him, images plastered on everything from ride signage to basketball games, often a specific image to reflect the activity. His out-of-print autobiography is randomly on display in the food court, and he is absolutely everywhere in the gift shop. This shop sells Mr. Tayto versions of every product you can imagine. Notebooks, erasers, mugs, t-shirts, plush, Christmas tree decorations, chocolate. I would love to see how the gift shop fares next year, as I think the sales will be way lower, and I'd be curious to see what they fill up all this space with. Beyond Mr. Tayto himself, one part of the park's visual identity is that on all the buildings, which have this wooden Hunter's Lodge sort of vibe to them, there are these blocky blue signs, which you may recognise is the same font and colour as the Tayto logo. Presumably this is copyrighted as part of Tayto's brand identity, and so will also have to be replaced as part of the park's upcoming rebrand. Up until 2020, the most obvious link between Tayto Park and Tayto Crisps was the factory tour. As I mentioned earlier, Ray Coyle decided to open his park opposite his Largo Foods crisp factory. This wasn't just out of sheer laziness of him building a park on the first plot of land he saw, but so guests could cross a bridge over to the factory and see the crisps being made as part of their visit. Every day I regret not getting to do this as part of my first visit to the park in 2018, as the next time I went it was closed due to COVID. I was optimistic this year that it might have finally reopened with all the COVID restrictions being lifted in Ireland, but I emailed ahead of time and they sadly confirmed it never reopened after the pandemic. I imagine partly due to the strained relationship between these two companies. One thing that separates this factory tour from other prominent brand experiences in central Dublin, such as the Jameson Experience or the Guinness Storehouse, which actually gets more annual visitors than Tayto Park, in this you actually get to see crisps being manufactured. Those aforementioned experiences, whilst great, are remarkably detached from any actual production facilities. I understand why companies try and separate these off. It's not hard to imagine how annoying it would be as an employee to just be gawked at by tourists all day. I went to Trinity College Dublin, and I cannot tell you how irritating it was every time a group of tourists managed to tailgate their way into the library, and they just stand there and stare at you while you're trying to study. Still, from a tourist perspective, it's really cool to see production in action, and in this experience you were able to look out over the factory floor. Beyond this, there was video and projected content taking you through the crisp production process, a section detailing the history of other crisp brands owned by Largo Foods such as King's and Hunky Dory, and a room playing classic Tayto ads. One thing I've always found interesting about these visitor attractions based on different brands is they always feel like a big budget PR fluff piece that you're paying to have the privilege of experiencing. And so I do find it weird that Tayto Crisps, by not renegotiating this deal, are shuttering down the factory tour, which essentially amounts to one of these, a direct brand promotion experience. Next year, in such close proximity to the rebranded version of this theme park, will still be a factory producing thousands of packets of Tayto Crisps each day, unbeknownst to most visitors. It's like going through a breakup and still living across the road from your ex. Still, on my latest visit, they thankfully hadn't got rid of one of the simplest ways that Tayto Crisps makes an impact on your day at the park, and that's when you exit, they give you a free packet of Tayto, something I will deeply miss on future visits. And as you would expect, if at any point during the day you're craving a packet, Tayto Crisps is sold at pretty much every spot you could buy something within the park. With one notable exception. So there's a special snack at Tayto Park that is only sold at one location called the Twisted Chip, and it's essentially one really large crisp twisted around a stick, with, I want to say, a kind of gourmet vibe? When I first visited in 2018, I thought it was really cool that the park had an exclusive crisp that you could only get in the park itself, but sadly I was too broke at the time to justify spending €3 on a giant crisp. But I knew when I returned this was something I absolutely had to try, especially as I assumed this would be something that was leaving the park when the Tayto sponsorship ended. I even had it down on my to-do list as Tayto on a stick. I naturally went for the cheese and onion flavour, but it was flavoured very differently to a Tayto cheese and onion, with more of a cheese powder physically sitting on top of the crisp. I originally assumed this was an innovation made especially by Tayto for the park, but when I was in Efteling in the Netherlands, I was really surprised to walk past people eating a spiral crisp on a stick. I've since found out this is a fairly common and popular snack in theme parks in countries such as the Netherlands and Belgium. When visiting Tayto Park and enjoying my Twisted Chip, I couldn't help but notice that the Tayto brand wasn't anywhere on the building. It seemed to be its own separate brand. I thought the name was a little bit weird with the Americanized chip over the Irish term crisp, and knew this was something that I'd have to look into more when I got home, which led me to this very strange website that the Twisted Chip has. It turns out that the Twisted Chip is not only a brand not owned by Tayto Crisps, but not owned by Tayto Park either, being a fully independent brand from the two. The Twisted Chip appears to have opened at Tayto Park in around 2014, so predating the massive expansion to the park, originally operating out of a glorified tent before getting its own dedicated building in 2016. The Twisted Chips opening within Tayto Park predates Ray Coyle being ousted from Largo Foods, but still, I'm fascinated at the politics of what is essentially a competing, albeit extremely small, crisp brand operating within Tayto Park. It feels especially weird when it's clearly benefited off a perceived association with the Tayto brand. I know I'm much more likely to want to spend €3 on a giant crisp at a place called Tayto Park than I would be if I was at Efteling, for example. This being something that actually caused friction between Tayto Crisps and Tayto Park, I feel is fairly unlikely, but I do think it's a good example of the strange tension between the unified brand name on the door and the experience being created for guests. And I do think it's interesting that even with the rebrand, there will still be a significant crisp-related element in the park going forward. Overall, the way Tayto as a brand was linked to the park wasn't massively through tangible physical elements, and I can't imagine it's going to cost the park that much time or money to remove any assets owned by Tayto Park. It's primarily going to be changing the signage, pulling down the old statue, and shaving a few toperies, and a drop in the ocean compared to the €30 million being spent to relaunch this new version of the park. That money will primarily be going towards two intertwining steel Vekoma coasters set to open in 2024, one a suspended thrill coaster and the other a family boomerang, both looking likely to be clones of rides found at Trips Drill in Germany. When they originally announced these in 2020, I joked that they should call them cheese and onion and salt and vinegar, which I think in many ways reflects how most people, including myself who'd visited the park by this point, perceive the park's identity. Instead, these two new coasters will be part of the park's attempt to strike out with their new identity after losing the Tayto name, and I'll be interested to see what kind of theming and branding they go with for these coasters to reflect this. And based off the new name they've chosen for the park, I think I can make an educated guess on the kind of theme they might be going for here. That lighter back. Thanks. God, this stinks. To avoid brand confusion, Tayto Park had been holding off from announcing its new name until towards the end of the season. On the 29th of September 2022, so around 7.5 months after they initially announced that the name would be changing, news was brought of Tayto Park's brand new name. Now, you might be thinking at this point, what name could possibly replace one as iconic as Tayto Park? Well, are you ready? Emerald Park. Naturally, I have a lot of thoughts about this, but apparently they tested a bunch of names in their research, and this tested best. This may seem like a surprise, until you see the names it was tested against. I mean, Legends Park? Top Park? Megaland? At least they sensibly did not try to go for another title sponsorship and replace Tayto with another brand, although with the history between the two companies, this never really existed in the conventional sense anyway. Clearly, they knew that no other brand within the Irish market had the same emotive power as Tayto, and instead will be pivoting to more sponsorships of individual attractions, which is much more common in the theme park industry. Whilst I'm glad they decided not to go for another company sponsoring the park, there was an opportunity here for the most iconic and chaotic possible scenario, which would have been Northern Irish Tayto choosing to sponsor the park, which I'm assuming wouldn't be possible legally, which is a shame because it would have been really funny. Broadly online, the consensus I saw was fairly negative, which is to be expected for any name change announcement. However, I do feel like there's something a bit off about this name as a choice. The positive reactions I saw online were mainly from international theme park enthusiasts, talking about it being a perfect match for a park in Ireland. And I do understand the rationale behind the new name. As I mentioned before, with the addition of Viking Voyage and Cú Chulainn, Tayto Park has been shifting from this irreverent, playful sort of Irishness that the Tayto name indicates to a broader sense of Irish identity, and this name, while still very Irish, is less specific than the Tayto name is. And also, presumably, this indicates that whatever theme they go for with their 2024 editions will be building off this Irish history and mythology vibe of their previous expansions. The reason this name feels weird is because of who uses the term the Emerald Isle. It's a very touristy and particularly American term used to describe Ireland. It's not something that really any Irish people sincerely use to describe their country. This is something the park seems to be aware of, as in the press release for their new name they say,
"Ireland is often referred to as the Emerald Isle by international visitors, and Meath is known throughout Ireland for its lush green countryside, so the new name has relevance and resonance."
So they seem to acknowledge this is a very international phrase, and then mention Meath's reputation within Ireland for being particularly green, and therefore that means this is going to resonate with Irish people, which feels like a PR spin after coming up with your name, rather than an actual factor in choosing it. I think this choice of name clearly indicates a punt for more international visitors, which is ambitious. Take London as an example. It's a far larger city with more annual visitors than Dublin, and yet nearby theme parks Chessington and Thorpe Park, despite being larger, more fleshed out parks with better transport links than Emerald Park, get essentially no international visitors because, well, why would they? No offence. I have an annual pass. I do love them. Legoland Windsor is more likely to attract some international families visiting London due to its extremely strong family-friendly brand, but it's really hard to build a park of the size and stature to draw a decent international crowd. Whilst I admire the ambition, Emerald Park is frankly decades away from that at the current expansion rate. As I mentioned earlier, due to the name change, they can now directly advertise outside of the Republic of Ireland with their new Taytoless name. However, I think this primarily opens up the opportunity to bring in more people from Northern Ireland, where much of the population is within driving distance, and not really anywhere where you'd have to fly in to visit, as I think it's difficult to justify the flight over unless you're a fairly hardcore theme park enthusiast. Again, no offence. Before, what was so effective about the Tayto name was how strongly it connected to its core Irish audience. What made the park a success was the chance to have a fun family day out without going abroad, and I can't see the park's core visitor base changing anytime soon. In the press release, it says that work is already underway to rebrand all elements of the park before the new year, and some of these cosmetic changes are already visible, such as them adding flags with their new logo to the lift hill of Cú Chulainn. But the name change doesn't officially take hold until the 1st of January 2023, and maybe it's my naive optimism, but I don't think it's too late for them to change their mind. Okay, so remember when Disney and Sony were going to stop making Spider-Man films together, and then Tom Holland had a drunken phone call with the CEO of Disney, so they went back to the negotiating table and worked out a deal. I feel like I'm Tom Holland here, except way less buff, but for the life of me, I cannot see how this is not a mutually beneficial partnership to continue. From Tayto Park's side, next year Cú Chulainn will still be there, the Viking Voyage will still be there, and the Potato Hunters Native American Village will thankfully not be there. The park isn't closing, this isn't defunct land. Going forward, the park should still feel essentially the same, with any major changes being major additions. And yet, it still feels like the park's unique identity, its soul, is being ripped out. Most importantly, it's the loss of what the original name provided, the emotive connection to the Tayto brand, and it'll be hard to build a new brand from scratch with the same level of meaning. And maybe Emerald Park will prove me wrong and really connect with people, and I hope it does, I'm rooting for it to be a success, but I don't think it'll ever manage to be a more iconic name. Because instead of being that Irish Chris-themed park, Emerald Park will be a quite nice, fairly small, not very notable theme park that happens to be an island. Whilst from Tayto Chris' side, the park creates a deep emotional connection to the brand, which is much harder to do via traditional advertising through relatively little effort on their part. I know this is a sample of one, but as I mentioned before, I know how much more Tayto I bought after visiting the park for the first time. It strongly influenced my brand loyalty. People ultimately don't care who owns who or who's paying who, but how the end result makes them feel. And Tayto Park was something special. That'll be gone at the end of the year. So look, maybe the two companies will have a last minute change of heart and get back to the negotiating table. But assuming they don't, the truth is, people are stubborn, hate name changes, and there'll always be those who refer to things by their original name. I'm still stunned by how commonly I hear the term Euro Disney, despite the fact the park was renamed to Disneyland Paris in 1994. Tayto Park may not be called Tayto Park next year, but it will live on as Tayto Park in our hearts. But as the park once said about its zoo animals, unfortunately, death is inevitable. Tayto Park is dead. Long live Tayto Park. Is Mr. Riley? I'm Mr. Riley, creator of Malta's favourite snacks? Huh.
Baby, you were born this way. No medication, a violence, being transgender.